Okay, I'm gonna be talking kind of quietly because there's a sleeping baby in the other room, but I have one of these PID controllers that are around on eBay for $10 or so. But there are a couple problems with it that everyone seems to know, and everyone seemed to know before I purchased mine. I'm planning to use it with solid state relay, maybe this one, and this isn't really designed for that. So instead of just triggering a solid state relay and allowing you to turn on the heating elements, that's what I'm doing with this, is controlling a toaster oven for resin casting and for maybe for reflow soldering. So if you want this to just trigger a solid state relay, which will activate the heating elements, then this isn't really designed for that. Instead, it's actually triggering this regular relay, which actually causes whatever the mains power, so in my case it'd be 110 volts, to actually be switched through here. This is only capable of 3 amps, so my toaster oven would probably kill this relay anyway. So the solid state relay is obviously a better choice, and also there's a lot of I haven't tried this yet, so I don't know, but I assume there's a lot of turning on and off, which is also kind of weird for a regular relay like this. So the idea is to fix that. Also, at least one person has noticed that all these LEDs on the front draw more current than this voltage regulator, the 7805, can supply. So you can see right there, that's a like the small kind, I forget what that is, SOT23 or something. That's the small kind of voltage regulator, and sorry, I'm just trying to get a pointer here. That's it right there, with 3 pins on it. And that used to convert, well, it converts basically to 5 volts DC for all of the electronics for this stuff. So then the other thing I want to do is replace that with a TO220 7805, so it'll be able to supply more current. So I guess what this person was seeing was that the lights on the front were dimming, and that was causing some weirdness with the accuracy of this thing. So that's the second thing. Actually, I've written it down, what I'm trying to change. And that's not the second thing, that's the third thing. So the first thing is to get rid of the relay that's on there and allow this to use the solid state relay instead. And then in the middle, the other thing is, I bought this assuming that what people said was correct, or at least what the documentation said somewhere was correct, and that it would run on 220 volts, or I don't know, some anywhere between 90 and 220 volts AC, which is not true. So this transformer takes the 220 volts AC and translates it to 10 volts DC over here and 12 volts DC over here, and then in the middle we have ground. So that doesn't work when you have 110 volts. These values are quite a bit lower, and in fact, this 10 volts supplies the 7805 with its DC voltage, which then gets converted down to 5 volts. So already, without knowing too much, I'm kind of self-taught and doing this seat of the pants, as most people are. I've measured here, and this is only like 6 volts or something, which for a 7805 I think is not enough to create 5 volts. So it's only creating like 4 something. So that right away there's a problem. So this is not designed to run on 110 volts AC, which I need. I'm in the US. So what I'd like to do is instead allow this to run on 9 volts DC or 12 volts. It won't really matter. The only place that this DC voltage is going to be used is, first of all, to supply the 7805, which runs this 5 volt logic, and then also to trigger the solid state relay, which most of them have a pretty wide range, 3 to 32 volts DC on this one. So anything between 9 12 volts will be okay, and unfortunately that means for my toaster oven, I'll have a plug for the heating elements, and I'll also have a separate wall wart to run this thing, which is not that big of a deal. I'll put a jack on the side of the toaster oven and plug it in from there. So that's my plan, to do all three of these things, and I'm just trying to document all of them as I usually do, mostly so that I remember what I did, but also because it'll probably help someone else somewhere along the line. So some of what I'm doing is just following what other people have figured out, but if you follow these traces, you can understand what's happening. There's a transistor right here which triggers this relay. Here's the control voltage for the relay, and so this ends up being ground, this ends up being 12 volts, and that's what's triggering the relay. But you can also just take that ground and 12 volts and bring that out to here, which is where we'll connect the solid state relay. So here's the back of this thing. I just disconnected this, and the way you disconnect it is just by pushing this clip. The whole thing slides out of this plastic part. Don't try anything more drastic. So you can see here that it's all these are labeled. It says 220 volts. That's for these two screw terminals, and then the output would be for our solid state relay, these two here, 4 and 5, and then on 9 and 10 will be the thermocouple, and I'm not using the alarm, so that's about it. So let's go on to the first thing, which is removing this relay and switching it up so that it'll use these two pins for the solid state relay's control voltage. What I'm going to do is just unsolder these unsolder the relay from here, and then just jumper some wires over. Again, this is 12 volts and this is ground, so I'll just bring ground over to here, and then I'll bring this 12 volts over to here, and that should do it. So then when I connect the solid state relay, I'll connect this to the minus terminal and this to the plus terminal. So let's see if we can make that happen. Okay, so I've removed the relay. There's the relay that used to be here. Of course, there are two relays, so you're not trying to remove that one. That's for the alarm. But I've removed the relays, and then I've just made a jumper from here to here, and then one from here to here. And that's so that, again, we have plus and minus for the solid state relay. These will trigger the relay, as opposed to the way it used to be, where these three pins are actually used to switch the 220 volts through this relay that was in here, which is too small to help with my oven, and probably what most people are doing with this. But maybe you have some low current situation and you could leave this setup alone instead of using a solid state relay. It's a lot cheaper too. So here are the jumper wires in the back. Next thing I'll do is try and make this run off of 12 volts instead of 12 volts DC instead of 220 AC, which I don't have in the US. So you know, my temptation is just to remove a lot of parts that I don't need, but it looks like this actually has some structural reason for being there too. So it actually is keeping this from these two boards from coming together, which is necessary because if you look inside the case, there's just these spring kind of terminals. So if these two were to start squeezing in, the connection probably wouldn't be as good. So I'll have to leave that in place, and instead I'll just sever these traces. And even though this transformer used to put out 10 volts here and 12 volts here, which I only know from, I know they're different, but I don't know I wasn't able to measure 10 and 12 because I don't have 220, but that's what many other people have found. So instead, I'm just gonna have both of them run off of 12 volts or 9 volts, because they will feed, the 10 volts used to feed this 7805, which gives the 5 volts to this all the control circuit, the logic circuitry, and then this 12 volts was feeding the relay here. And I have a lot of latitude because the 7805, especially the one that I'm going to replace the 7805 with, has a pretty wide range that it can take for a voltage, and also the solid state relay is a huge range. So I'm saying it'll run off of 12 volts DC, but maybe 9 volts, could even run off of a 9 volt battery, probably. So, whatever the case, I'm going to have basically these jumper together so they're the same voltage, and then I'll connect this middle one to ground. What I'd like though is to be able to use the screw terminals on the back, so I will jumper a wire from here out to there and from here out to there so that I have my plus and minus on the screw terminals, and that's where I'll connect my wall wart. So I'll do some of that and then come right back. Okay, I'm back, and this is a very strange way of doing this. I'm soldering on top of the board. Also, I scratched out these traces that were connected to the transformer. Maybe it's not necessary, but I'm not an electrical engineer. I'm an artist, and I know just what I know. So I kind of feel better. I would have felt better about removing the transformer just so it wasn't involved in the circuit at all. But I just kind of severed these traces. Maybe it's not necessary. The other thing I did was make this jumper wire between what used to be one part of the transformer's output and the other. So one was 10 volts, one was 12 volts, and I've just jumpered them together so they're both connected to whatever this is connected to, which is going to be the positive part of my DC power supply. So again, kind of weird. I'm soldering on top of the board, but this is all vo low voltage now, so I'm not so concerned about things like safety, like I would have been if this was still going to be connected to 220 volts. So this is coming over to here, just so you understand what's going on. You can follow the traces yourself, but this is. Sorry, now I've covered things up. You can kind of follow and see that this is ground. These two are connected to each other. The traces are connected to each other, so that was used to be 10 volts. These two are connected to each other, those are ground. These two are connected to each other, those used to be 12 volts. And then this one is also ground. So this whole row here that's connected to these diodes is really just ground and power now, since everything else is since the lower and higher DC voltages are tied together now. So all of these pins are either power or ground. Not so complicated anymore. Again, I'm sure you could do this a different way, and I'm sure you could do it without involving the diodes at all, but I'm trying to just make as little change as possible. If you look over here, this is the 7805. That's the last step. Those three pins, the 7805 takes an input voltage and turns it into 5 volts, and so that's the pin for the input. The way I can tell is just follow these around. The middle one definitely looks like it's going to ground. The one over here definitely goes over to this trace, which they've labeled 5 volts, and you can see here the middle one goes to the label that says ground, so that's convenient. So that means the last one has to be the input, even if you didn't want to trace everything around. You can just read. So what I'm going to do is replace this with a bigger 7805, the TO220 package, and on the other side of the board, and make sure that the pins still line up, input, ground, and output, which I think that's actually right, input, ground, and output. I'll double check though before I put this in, and then hopefully that should do it. Okay, so I forgot to mention too that I see some resistors and a capacitor. I did remove those from before the transformer. Again, may not be necessary, but I think it's at least a good idea to just snip off those resistors. The capacitor was going between plus and minus. Without knowing what value it was, I figure I should just get rid of it. Could stay there as a decoupling capacitor, but I don't know if that's the value that we got. So I just removed them. You see them there. Back to the 7805. I marked them here as input, ground, and output. And you can see here, this is input, ground, and output. That's the orientation that it should be in. And I think that's it. At this point, I'm just going to put it back together and plug it all in and hope it doesn't turn into a smoky mess. Okay, so here it is all wired up. I took all the guts out of the toaster except for the thermocouple, and I just kind of snipped the wires because it's not one that works with the PID controller. I've got a solid state relay with a heat sink attached and some thermal paste all on the underside. Here's the 9-volt power supply. It goes to a barrel jack in the back. So, like I said, I'll have to have the 110-volt cord and also a 9-volt DC wall wart, which is okay with me. Here's the front where we've basically taken off the panel and then set this in here. It's worth knowing that these plastic clips are really pretty nice. They make sure that this thing stays in place without any screws or anything if you have a square hole for it. I think that's mostly about it. Here's basically how I wired everything. There's the 9-volt DC power that's supplying the 12, well, the 9 volts to the solid state relay when necessary, and also the 5 volts is being created from that 9 volts to power the controls for the PID on the front. Pins 9 and 10 here are the negative and positive for the K-type thermocouple that I got with the PID controller. And then from there, basically, each one of these resistor symbols is the pair of heating elements. So this is the top pair of heating elements, that's the bottom pair of heating elements, or vice versa, or whatever. So they're wired in parallel, and then that goes back up to 110 volts AC, and the other leg of the 110 goes to pin one on the solid state relay. I need to put a fuse in here still, but I will do that. The only other thing worth mentioning is I'm not sure if this will do a good enough job, but I have this kind of probably imitation Kapton tape. I just kind of line the wall here so that I can try and keep some heat out. I don't know if that'll actually work, but it may. And if I have to, I'll wire a fan, probably put it right here to pull air out of here. We'll see. And then the other thing worth noting is that the thermocouple, I think, I don't quite understand the different types, but there are grounded and ungrounded thermocouples. The one that I got works fine as long as I'm holding it in the air, but if I touch it to any metal part of the chassis, which is of course also connected to ground, then it freaks out, and the PID controller just basically shows the temperature rising to above the limit immediately almost. So I did a couple things. I mean, I don't think this really helped, but I did put Teflon tape on the threads. But basically, I just had to kind of readjust so that instead of the thermocouple tip just barely coming out and the metal part making contact with the threads of the holder, I just kind of have it coming out a bit more so that it's just suspended in midair here. And I did get like a steel bushing to thread this into. That just seemed like the best way to keep that thing in there because there's, this is super thin and there's not really any room to hold the threads. So that's it. I've turned it on. Works okay. I think I have some fooling around to do with the PID controller, figure out how to work through the menus and get it working the way I want. But I did turn it on. I saw the, luckily this. Well, luckily, I don't know. This solid state relay you can see right there behind the white wire, it has an LED, so it shows you when it's turning on. I was going to put one on the front just so you can see when the elements are on. I may still wire one in here, but I may also just put a hole in the top of the oven because I think it's only really for troubleshooting that I'll want to know if the solid state relay is going on and off. Otherwise, I would just pay attention to the point value on here. So that's about it. I think the only other thing is now that I'm looking at this, I realize I have some fiberglass high temperature wires and I didn't use them here. I think just because I happen to have these handy really heavy gauge wire, but it is plastic, and I don't know where that came from, but I don't think it came from this oven. So I'm gonna probably just take that off and use some of this type of stuff, this fiberglass housed wire. And another thing I have here is just to connect these, I use this ceramic terminal instead of a plastic one. So other than that, I don't really care about, since everything in here is pretty much low voltage now, except for what goes to the solid state relay and the heating elements. I use really pretty thin gauge wire for the relay control and for the 9 volts. So it's a little less hectic in here without a bunch of really thick gauge wires. That's it. Don't ask me any questions because I think I've told you everything I know so far. But good luck, and hopefully this answers some questions for.